Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
We're 9 games into this season, and the Flames have their worst record in 18 years as we start off the season with a 2-7 record. Matt and I, as always, are here to break down what's going on, and maybe we'll be able to get some clarity on what's happening with the Flames season. How are you feeling at this point in the year, Matt?
It could be a lot better. The Flames, as you said, are off to their worst start in 18 years. That's not exactly ideal, but it is what it is, and now it's just how will the Flames respond, and what will happen in terms of the roster moving forward.
And 18 years ago, the year that we're referencing, when we had a worse start, that was actually the year that had the lowest number of points in franchise history, when the Flames ended with only 67 points. So if we put that into modern times, that's really not looking good for us this year.
No, but realistically, the Flames haven't been as bad as their record has shown, so we'll see. A lot of bad bounces and kind of fluky plays have conspired over the past few weeks to really deflate the team. And, like, we've seen some inopportune moments, like the second goal on Ortio yesterday that deflected off of Kris Russel. There's not really much that, you know, the Flames can do when a weird bounce goes against them, and it just seems to knock them off their stride.
You know, it's interesting, because if you look at the Flames last year, I think a lot of their success was contributed to getting weird bounces in their favor. And this year, they're struggling, and a lot of the struggle is being contributed as getting weird bounces against them. So, I don't know, maybe it's the hockey gods kind of coming back to even things out.
Like, if you look at Karri Ramo, like, a lot of the goals that he surrendered in his starts, weird deflections off of players' skates, off like Dennis Wideman accidentally putting the puck in the net, just really bizarre things. It seems like whenever there's a break in a game, it's going against the Flames, and even like the other team getting just a handful of scoring chances, it seems like every one of them's going in the net. Where the Flames, it's, you know, the goalie will make a great save, or it'll just miss the net, or hit the post. Just one of those things. Luck's just not on the Flames' side right at the moment.
Well, let's talk about some of those bounces. Let's talk about some individual games that we've seen over the past week. Since we talked last, there's been 4 games. The Flames played against the Capitals, the Red Wings, the Rangers, and the Islanders. And right now we're in the middle of 5 games in 7 days. So let's start breaking these down one at a time. And why don't we start with the game last Tuesday when the Capitals came to town. As you and I mentioned last week, we've traditionally had problems against the Capitals, and this was a 6-2 loss to the hands of Washington. What were your thoughts on that game, Matt?
Well, the Flames actually played pretty good in the first period against them, and then a weird goal happened right off the bat in the second period.
The Alex Ovechkin goal 30 seconds in.
Yeah. Like, Ramo makes the first save, appears to have it, but instead the puck trickles just off to the side of him. He doesn't see it. Ovechkin's like, oh, free goal, thanks. You know, what do you do? And the rest of the team's like, oh, well, here we go again. And it just knocked them off their game entirely, and the Flames just never recovered after that.
Yeah, in that game, I think, you know, Monahan scored 9 with 9 minutes left in the first, and we really saw the Flames getting a jump about that time, and then Washington tied it up, and we still saw a good jump. And like you said, that Ovechkin goal just sort of deflated them, and they seemed to come apart at the seams after that point.
Yeah, and like for the remainder of the second period, it was like they were completely shell-shocked, and it was like they just couldn't string a pass together or anything. Everything just seemed to be messing up for them. Which has pretty much been emblematic of the Flames season. One little thing screws up and then, let's set our hair on fire and run around circles, not you know, resetting yourself and focusing and, you know, striking back.
Yeah. And then the next game after that was Friday night. The Flames played host to the Detroit Red Wings. And this was a 3-2 win. This gave the Flames their first win of the season, or their second win of the season, sorry. And I thought this was a pretty good game all in all. It wasn't the best effort we've seen, but I felt that for, you know, most of the 60 minutes, we saw a decent Flames performance. What were your thoughts?
Yeah, the first period, they ran into some penalty trouble, and those pucks ended up finding their way into the net. And then once the first period ended, the Flames turned on the Jets and started going at the team, sort of like how they played last season, and were just relentless, both in the second period firing 16 shots, and then the third period wearing the team down until they actually managed to tie it before winning it in overtime.
Yeah, I thought that, like you said, they didn't play great in the first. They ran into some penalty trouble, but I'd say probably the last 7 or 8 minutes of the first, they started playing well. I thought the second, we saw some good Flames hockey on both ends of the ice. And the third, even though they were playing well, I thought that they started to look like they were running out of gas by the end.
True. And that is a good point that you brought up. I think one of the main problems that the Flames have had is that they're looking tired out there. And like, especially in the Islanders game, which was the second night of a back-to-back, like, they just look tired out there. And like, they're not skating hard, and everything's just a little sluggish. It's just strange after seeing, like, the never-ending motor last season to see how much the team has changed without really changing any personnel.
And what do you think might be causing some of that sluggishness, in your opinion?
I know that the Flames did have troubles with the flu earlier in the season, so that might have sapped some of their conditioning, because I know that, like, if you get the flu, like, and you're an athlete, you can lose weight, and it usually takes you a while to get back into the swing of things. Other than that, like, it doesn't make much sense how much this team has changed how they're playing, when nothing's changed, really. Like, yes, Dougie Hamilton struggled a bit, but, you know, you can't pin the whole rest of the 20 players, you know, their problems all on his shoulders.
Nope. Everyone has to play their way if we're going to get a team effort every night.
Yeah. Like, the only guy that's looked like himself from last season is Gaudreau. Everybody else, it's like, who are you people, and where have you stuck the Flames that we used to know?
So let's finish off the week. The Flames took Saturday off as they traveled to New York. On Sunday night, they were in the Big Apple, and they took on the New York Rangers in Madison Square Garden. Before this game, we found out that Michael Ferland got injured and Derek Grant was recalled. Thoughts on Grant's recall?
He played well in Stockton in the games that I watched. He was probably the Flames' most consistent offensive threat. And he had a good training camp, so he's getting rewarded with the handful of games. It was good to see that, you know, the mantra of, you know, always earned, never given, it, in his case, he earned it. And, like, he played 3 games in Stockton and he had 3 goals, so he deserved to be the one rewarded. And he played rather well in the 2 games.
Yeah, I was surprised that he got called up, simply because I was thinking that there were guys like Bill Arnold who were probably higher on the depth chart and more in line to get a call-up, not just based on this year's work, but sort of their whole body of work. So I was sort of surprised when I heard that Grant was the guy that got the nod.
Oh, so was I. But if you're going based on a pure meritocracy, he was the best of the bunch. And, you know, that's also a good thing in terms of being able to sell the Flames to free agents is that, you know, you might be an outsider coming in, but if you work hard regardless, you're going to play.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's true. It does show that. It shows that, you know what, he came in, he was sort of the veteran. We were kind of expecting him to be the forward version of Corey Potter and, you know, not get a lot of play time, if any. And, yeah, definitely the fact that he came in and he showed it, he earned it. I think that's good for the team. It shows there's no favoritism, whether we drafted you or whether we brought you in as a free agent. Everyone's on the same playing field.
Yeah, if you're going to contribute the most, get out there. Go.
So, yeah, and you're right. He did look pretty good. I mean, he didn't play a lot of minutes, but he did look pretty good from what we saw. So let's talk about the Rangers game Sunday night. I thought in this game, this might have been the best whole game effort that we saw from the Flames all year. I think we saw probably the best 60 minutes of hockey that we've seen since the puck dropped on the 2015-2016 season.
I'd have to agree. And the fact that it was a 4-1 loss doesn't really reflect how the game was. Like, that game could have easily been a 3-2 score for Calgary. It just, when it rains, it pours. And
I know in the past we've talked about how some of the goals haven't always been able to be attributed to the goaltenders. I think in this one, a lot of those goals were directly attributed to Jonas Hiller.
Yes. Oh, for sure. Especially that third one, which ended up being the backbreaker.
The Kevin Klein goal?
Yeah, the one where he kicked out the rebound, and yeah, that was not a stellar effort in the goaltending situation there.
And
I
thought it was interesting that a guy who came off, you know, I would say a decent game of his on Friday against the Red Wings, and just saw his partner sent down to the minors, which we'll talk about later, I was expecting that he'd come out guns blazing. And I think that we can say that maybe the only Flames player who didn't have a, you know, complete 60-minute effort the way we need them to was Hiller.
Yeah.
It's almost like he was handing Ordeo the job. It's like he's, you know, kind of going out and saying, hey, I can't do this. Yoni, it's your net. But it goes back to the inconsistency that we've always seen from Hiller.
True enough. And that's part of the reason why the Flames are 2-7 thus far. If it's not one thing, it's another. And what do you do? You know, the Flames have their best effort on the ice all season, as you said, and the goaltender lets in a couple of stinkers. Well, that's your ball game right there. And
interesting note in that one, the New York Rangers played Antti Raanta in net, their backup goaltender, and he has never lost a home game in regulation time during his tenure as an NHL goalie. So,
yeah, he's 16-0-3.
So thanks to the Flames, he's kept that record intact. And, you know, it's kind of, I don't know, it's a bad sign when teams are already starting to play their backup against you in the first month of the season.
Oh, yeah. And realistically, with how the Flames are playing, wouldn't you?
Yeah, well, that's it. We deserve it. But, I mean, the fact that you can confidently sit a guy like Henrik Lundqvist, who's the undisputed starter there, and say, you know what, let's give our backup an early start, that's a little bit shameful. Like, usually the backups aren't getting much play time, if any, in September and October, and already Rant is 2-0-0.
Perhaps if the other teams continue to play their backups against Calgary, that maybe the Flames might be able to get some goals and get some momentum built up and, you know, start forcing the other teams to play their starters.
Maybe. We'll see. Some interesting notes from the Rangers game. I figure there's a good one to look at a little bit more in depth. Just because the Flames did play a fairly good night. If you look at all the forwards and the dot in that game, Colborne won 50% of his faceoffs. Juris won 50%. Stajan won 67%. Monahan won 53%. Hudler won 100%. I think he only took one because somebody got kicked out. Grant won 56%, but Backlund won 27% of his faceoffs. And for a team that's trying to, you know, push themselves this year to get better, you got to be having your centers winning more than 27%. That's a terrible metric.
That's part of the reason why if they're... Like, if this continues, especially with how Backlund specifically has struggled this season, if a trade does come up and he's involved, that wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing. With the Flames having such a large amount of center depth, you need to have guys that can win faceoffs. And Backlund, all through his career, has been somewhat iffy at that. I think his best season was 51.
Well, so far, if we look over last week, in the Islanders game, Backlund won 40% of the draws. In the Capitals game, Backlund won 47% of the draws. In the Red Wings game, Backlund won 56% of the draws. So, I mean, you know, of all those games, only one of them has he won at least half the faceoffs. And to me, anything over 50% is decent. I mean, you can't win them all. If you can win half of them at least, you're in a good spot.
Yeah, it's just that, especially because he's like the defensive line center,
And you'd almost expect him to win more, so that we have possession of the puck, you know, especially
yeah, exactly.
If we're in our own
like
end.
If you look at a guy like, say, Jarrett Stoll with Los Angeles, he would play the same role on the team as Backlund, and yet he's one of the top faceoff guys. And that's part of the reason why he's in that spot, so that way, you know, you have your defensive zone faceoff, he'll go out and win the draw most of the time.
And Backlund's also a guy who's used a lot on the shorthand. And if you're playing shorthanded, you got to be winning those draws.
Exactly. And it's one of those situations where if value can be in trade, can be utilized, then it's not necessarily a bad thing if he does eventually get traded.
Before we talk trades, let's look at the last game of the week. I was excited for the back-to-back on the New York trip. We saw 8 minutes of Yoni Ordio at the end of the Islander or at the end of the Rangers game. He went in. I thought he looked good for the 8 minutes. Nothing got past him, which, you know, at that point, it wouldn't really matter anyways. Then the next night, Ordio got the start against the Islanders. Coming off such a good effort from the Flames, I was really excited. And coming into the Islanders game, I felt like the Flames had, as they have all year, they had good patches of hockey. I can't point to even a whole period where they were good. It was a couple minutes here, a couple minutes there, a couple minutes here, and they need to play 60 minutes. I think that's all we can say at this point. In order to win, they have to play a 60-minute hockey game.
Even if they get 20 minutes, that would be a major improvement for what we've seen for most of the season. And like, even in the Red Wings game, they were kind of iffy in the first period, but they turned it on in the second and the third. So if they can get 40 minutes, 20 minutes here, 40 minutes there, they can come out on the winning end of it. It's just getting more than like two or three shifts in a row, and then that's it for the next 10 minutes.
And again, I think in this game, as we saw in other games, I mean, all the goals came in the last, in the second, and then three in the third in the Islanders game. And really, to me, as we've seen a few times, they just seemed to get frustrated and sort of fell apart in the third.
Yeah. Well, like the goal that tied it in the second period, the Flames were on the penalty kill, and they have a tight box style penalty kill. And yet they let Grabowski stand right in front of the net to receive the pass, and he was allowed to shoot it into the net, and there was nobody around him. And it's like, how did you have that bad of a defensive breakdown when you're in a tight defensive box to allow a guy that much room? Like, he should have been mobbed by England before he even got the puck. And you know, it's just the things that are attention to details that it's just frustrating.
And those are the kind of details that I might expect a young guy like a Kulak maybe to make, but not a veteran guy like England.
No, and it seems like the entire team is just having like these really basic things that they're just not doing. And it's not guys like, say, just Dougie Hamilton, because I know he's been getting a lot of heat lately. It's everybody. Like, Like, Kris Russel has been terrible this season, defensively, and yet he's not being complained about. His plus-minus is actually worse than Hamilton's, and yet I haven't heard anybody complaining about how poorly Russell's played.
Yeah, I think, though, the expectations are different. I mean, if you look at where Russell is in the lineup, if you look at what he's making, I think that there's very different expectations, you know, what it costs to acquire them. More eyes and more pressure are going to be on Dougie Hamilton just because of what we gave up to get him, where he's positioned, you know, on the lineup, that sort of thing.
Oh, I know. Well, the point I'm trying to illustrate is that, like, it's not just one guy. It's like everybody in the team is having their own struggles. Like, even Giordano was not playing well through the first six games before turning it on starting in the Washington game in the third period when he scored to get the Flames, I do believe, within one at that point.
So looking at maybe one of the bright spots in the New York trip, Laddie Smead came back, played his first game as a Flame this pretty much since December of last year. He wears number 15, which is sort of weird because every time I think of him, I still think of him as wearing 3, the number he wore when he first started with the Flames. I'm a little bit surprised the Flames didn't send him to the AHL for a conditioning stint, but really, if you look at him, he didn't seem like he needed it. He seems like he was able to jump right back in, especially in the New York game, and actually looked like he's ready to play at the NHL level, in my opinion anyways. What did you think of Smead?
I actually thought he was one of the better defensemen.
I did too.
In the two games. He was not making the same mistakes as guys like Englund and Russell, even to another extent, Hamilton and at times Wideman and Giordano. I thought he was the most composed of all the defensemen. Just doing his job, not making the simple mistakes that a lot of the other players have been.
Yeah, no, I think you're probably definitely right there. Just taking a look at Smead and his time on ice for the two games. In the first game against the Rangers, we didn't see a whole lot of Smead, and that makes sense because if you think about it, he was, you know, they're probably testing him out, not sure how much time he can play or anything like that, but he played 10 minutes, 53 seconds. And in the second game, the game against the Islanders, he played 12 minutes and 1 second. And you know what? He's probably the freshest guy on our team. I mean, even for the back-to-back, these are the first games he's played in over 6 months. So makes sense why maybe he's got a little bit of extra zip to him.
Oh, for sure. And I'm just hoping that he continues his excellent play and can get back into the swing of things and contribute to the team a lot moving forward.
So, Matt, you've been talking every show since the season started about how you want the Flames to solve the three-headed monster problem, as you've been referring to it as, having three goaltenders at the NHL level. We were carrying Joni Ordio, Karri Ramo, and Jonas Hiller. And this week, the Flames finally solved that problem for you. We found out late last week that the Flames placed Karri Ramo on waivers. Myself, I'm a little bit surprised that he didn't get claimed. And then as soon as he cleared waivers, he was sent down to the Stockton Heat, which leaves the Flames with two goaltenders. It leaves them with Hiller and Ordio. So first, let's talk a little bit about Ramo on waivers. Were you surprised that that's the route that the Flames decided to take?
Not really. They needed to figure out the goalie problem, and with the Flames having such a terrible start through the first six games, they needed to sort it out. When they start 1-5, you have to get rid of any distractions possible, and that was a distraction.
Do you think they made the right choice in sending Ramo down?
It's one of those things that both guys have been equally terrible, but for different reasons. So, if you would have said Hiller was the one getting waived, I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. And with Ramo getting waived, yeah, that makes sense. It had to be one or the other. Ramo is coming off the most recent poor performance, and so he was the one that got axed. And realistically, he was the guy that was less likely to get claimed on waivers, because I think just the name Hiller would have been more enticing to a team like Buffalo, where Ramo, well, he's just, you know, there.
Yeah, a lot of people have asked me since it happened, why didn't anyone claim him, or why don't I think? And the big thing people have to remember is if a player gets claimed off waivers, they have to stay at the NHL level for the team to claim them for the remainder of the season. So that team couldn't send Ramo down to the AHL at any time. So I think you're right there. I think that with Hiller, you'd say, you know what, at least we've got a good backup out of this guy. We can send our other backup down. But with Ramo, I think there's going to be a lot more uncertainty there. Well, maybe we'd want to send this guy down. We don't want to have to carry him all year. And I think that fact alone is why Ramo ended up clearing waivers.
True. And it also makes it a little bit easier for other teams now, like especially if the Flames were to, say, eat half of Ramo's contract. If the acquiring team just leaves him in the AHL, it'll only end up costing them about $1 million on their cap hit instead of the 3.8.
You know what? At this point, I don't see them trading him and taking on part of his salary. Considering he's only on a one-year deal, I think it's one of those things that if you can't trade him outright on a one-year, you'll probably just hang on to him.
True.
I think that if we're going to try and trade away some salary, there's bigger contracts to do that with and more important contracts to do that with than a goalie on a one-year deal. I think the Flames will probably just eat the money.
Probably. Plus, you never know. Like, if, say, Hiller continues to play poorly like he did in the Rangers game, you might end up seeing them getting swapped at some point.
So I think that, you know, I don't see him and Hiller moving around too much because I don't think you're going to sneak both guys up and down on waivers.
And plus, Ramo's contract is a lot more palatable than, you know, 3.8.
I don't necessarily think we've seen the last of Karri Ramo. I'm not surprised he cleared waivers because I don't think there's any team that wants to have that guarantee of carrying him all year. But I could see him maybe coming up later if there's an injury, or maybe we do have a deal for Hiller later and we just need to bring him back up as the second goalie.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at the two goalies now, having Hiller and Ordio as the two goalies, and looking at Hiller's performance thus far compared to Ordio's game and 8 minutes of a game, who would you be running with if you were Hartley?
Ordio.
I think if Ordio's your guy of the future, which they're saying he is, and especially looking at the Flames' start and the fact that we're probably far from the playoffs at this point, I think you've got to be giving Ordio time.
If you look at how the last two games went, Jonas Hiller struggled and probably lost the game by himself against the Rangers. He allowed a couple of goals that were kind of iffy and killed any real momentum to try and come back. In the Islanders game, the entire Flames team played rather poorly, and it was a weird deflection goal on the second one, and just poor defensive coverage on the first, third, and fourth ones, where if the Flames were playing proper defense, I don't think any of those three chances would have materialized in the first place. So, just based on how each of the goalies has fared, I think it would be more fair to Ordio to allow him to run with it until he struggles and perhaps even loses a game like Hiller has.
Well, and having three games in 4 days for the rest of the week, we have a game Wednesday night against Ottawa, and then we have back-to-backs. If I were Hartley, I'd be playing Ordio in the game on Wednesday against Ottawa, and I'd probably play him in the Edmonton game as well. And let Hiller play, because you're not going to play him in both games back-to-back, so pick either Montreal or Edmonton. But I would definitely play him in Ottawa. I think he's earned the chance to play against the Senators as the next goalie up, and then take your pick on the back-to-back. Do you think that part of the Flames moving Ramo as early as they did and send him down is also sort of a message to the team that, hey, we're not afraid to get a veteran out of here if they're not performing well?
Yeah, And realistically, if the Flames' struggles continue, and say, like, the playoffs are out of the way by November, the middle of November, then realistically what the Flames should be doing is anybody that's over the age of 25, if we can trade you and it makes sense, see you later. And doesn't matter who you are outside of guys like Frolik and Giordano, like pretty much everybody else, they should be wary of the axe over their head, because the Flames need to, if they're going to be out of a playoff hunt early, you might as well just start looking at shipping out everybody that's not stapled down, and allow the guys like Marcus Granlund, Bill Arnold, Kenny Agostino, Kenny Morrison, and like everybody else that's close in Stockton to come up and take their spots.
So let's talk about that. So last year, the Flames made it to the second round of the playoffs. We lost to the Ducks. We had arguably a better season than anyone expected. Unless you're Aaron Ward at TSN, you didn't expect this to go nearly as long as it did. Now we're 2-7, with a tenth of the season played, the first 11 games now under our belt. The Flames aren't looking good. Is it time that we, as you're saying, trade everybody that's not stapled down and rebuild this team again, essentially, strip it to its parts? Or is this par for the course for year three of a rebuild?
Well, if you look at when the Edmonton Oilers, I'm going to use them as a comparable, when they tore down, they were still a full year away from acquiring Taylor Hall from where the Flames are now in their rebuild. So you would like them to have been successful, like, right, okay, we made the second round of the playoffs, let's build on that and go on to a cup contender. That didn't materialize thus far. And now the Flames are facing some adversity, probably the first true experience of adversity since the rebuild started, and now it's time to sort out the roster. And the Flames currently have over $30 million in contracts for guys that are playing on the third and fourth line, the third defense pairing, or, you know, in the press box, and the backup goaltender. Well, with a $70 million cap, you can't have 3/7 of it taken up by players that aren't very good.
No, but if they're not very good and they have a bad contract, it's going to cost us something to get rid of them, too.
Well, that's the thing, that a lot of those players, though, you can trade. Like a guy like, say, David Jones, he's making $4 million at the trade deadline. That's easily doable.
Well, but the trade deadline's a long way off, though. I mean, we're talking about, you know, what should the Flames be doing at this point going forward after 9 games? I mean, anything's, I think, doable if we're out of the playoffs at the deadline, but I think at the deadline you're going to see a lot of guys shopped. You'll probably see Hudler shopped. You'll probably see, you know, you'll see Jones shopped. You'll probably see, if he's still around, Raymond shopped. There's going to be a lot of guys. Wideman will probably be shopped. Russell will be shopped. Even Smead might be shopped if we're not in the playoffs. But at this point, I think it's too early to say, let's just start trading everybody.
No, but it's one of those situations where if a deal comes up and it makes sense, then...
Well, you never turn down a deal that makes sense. I mean, no GM in his right mind says, you know what, this is a good deal, but I'm going to pass because, you know, I don't want to take on a good deal. You always take a deal that makes sense. But I think if you're Treliving, are you out actively shopping these guys? Or are you kind of saying, you know what, we're going to stay par for the course? Of course, if a good deal comes in, you take it.
No, I actually would be shopping everybody and anybody, because you need to be...
But would you want to see wholesale change? Like you're saying, trade everyone not stapled down. So if the Flames were to go out and, say, trade 8 guys next week, do you think that's going to solve problems?
No, not necessarily. It would depend largely on the trades. But if those trades made sense in terms of the greater rebuilding picture, then sure, why not?
Do you think the Flames are off kelter with their rebuild? Do you think that there's piece of the rebuild they need to refocus on?
Yeah, they do. And
what parts do you think?
That's more asset management wise. And like, we saw them use 3 draft picks last year to get Dougie Hamilton, which realistically, the odds of any of those 3 picks becoming another Dougie Hamilton is small. They need to acquire more draft picks. And like, we are seeing the previous drafts, like from 2013 back, they're all pretty much, other than Jankowski and Rafikov, they've all graduated into the AHL. So, and those two might, well, Jankowski will be next year, and Rafikov, if he ever comes over, will as well. So the last 2 drafts, the Flames haven't had a huge amount of draft picks, so the Flames will need to get more moving forward. So if the Flames do eventually tear down some of the, and trade off some of the veteran guys, they should go after getting a bunch of draft picks, so that way they can start to rebuild the next wave of young guys coming up.
If I look at this team, and I'm not going to look as far out as the trade deadline, I'm looking at, say, November. If we're looking at this team with a 2-7 record going in November, let's say that we keep this pace where, let's say,
we win 1 out of the 3 games this week. 3-9.
3-9 or 3-10. Going into November, I don't think it's time to blow this thing up. I don't think that we go out and we start just trading guys for the sake of making a trade. I don't think you start trading guys like Jones and Hoover and moving these guys to blow it up. I agree with you a little bit about the draft picks. I don't think we're necessarily as dire as you might, but I think even in a rebuild, you have to have veterans there. If we look at Edmonton, part of their big problem was there's rookies trying to lead other rookies. So if we just get rid of all the vets and say, bring in Granlund, bring in, you know, whoever else, Arnold, we're not going to do ourselves a favor. When I look down the roster, I think for year 3 of the rebuild, we're right where we need to be as far as the guys in the roster are.
Yeah.
There's always room to make changes. Nobody's perfect, but, you know, it gives us room to play with. But if we're looking at young guys like, you know, 22-year-old Dougie Hamilton, we're looking at, you know, a 25-year-old Lance Boma, 25-year-old Joe Colborne, you know, Juris, Goudreau, Bennett, Monahan, Ferland, Grant, you know, Frolik's 27. The core of this team is exactly where we need it to be.
True. But most of the players that you would be ideally looking to deal are the guys that are, you know, like your Matt Stajans or...
Yeah, and as you said, if a good deal comes by, you take it, but I wouldn't be actively trying to blow this team up at this point.
No. It's one of those things that if a deal makes sense, then
you always
you make
take
it,
right? We say that every show. If the deal makes sense, you take it.
Yeah, you're not going to say, like, say, trade Kris Russel for a third-round pick or a second-round pick just because it's there.
But sometimes we see GMs who make a trade, not necessarily because the good trade is there, but because they feel they need to make a move, right? They feel they need to shake their team up.
Yeah, and that would be a mistake.
Yeah, I personally don't feel it's time to ship guys out just to ship guys out. Looking down the roster, and yes, we're not perfect, but looking down the roster, I think the Flames roster, where we need to be in year 3 of a 5-year rebuild, is exactly where we want it.
It's just one of those things that at some point the Flames should try to look to reassign some of the cap hits that, like that $30 million
And knowing True Living, he's probably actively looking at that. But, you know, like even moving a $3 million 3-year Matt Stajan is going to be a difficult contract to move. He's also modified no movement.
Well, it's one of those things that he's a good defensive center that can play offensively. So there are teams, especially if they have a lack of center depth, that he would be a good fit.
I think you'll see someone like Yari Hudler not re-signed here. I don't think you see Dave Jones come back. Those guys alone gives you $8 million left in the cap.
Yeah, I don't see either Hiller or Ramo coming back, so that's another 8.3. And like Kris Russel, I doubt you see him back either. So you know, if the Flames are out by the trade deadline, I would expect Calgary to be the most active team.
I don't think there's any doubt that by the trade deadline, we'd definitely be active if we're out. But if we're looking over the next month, to me, I don't think you go out and start shipping out pieces just to dismantle this team. You know, it's not like we built a team for the Stanley Cup, and now we're going, you know what, let's just ship these pieces out and start a rebuild. To me, I think in year three of our rebuild, we're exactly where we need to be. Yeah, our roster's not perfect. Nobody's roster's perfect if you look at all 30 teams. But to me, I think you've got, as you mentioned, you've got good pieces that you can move, which is important as a hockey team. You want pieces that'll bring you back assets. But if I look at the amount of young, upcoming players, I think we're positioned exactly where we want to be.
Yeah. It's just one of those things that you'd like to try and figure out some solution to the problem sooner than later to try and salvage the team. And
but I don't think we're necessarily in salvage mode. I mean, even if you look at the rookies that are coming up, you know, we've got to re-sign we have to re-sign Goudreau and we have to re-sign Monahan. We're going to free up $16 million. Those guys are done. Any other guy that comes up like a Poirier, we're going to have a couple years before we need to worry about a big contract on those guys. And looking at our salary cap chart, a lot of our big contracts will be done by then. You know, Raymond will be done 2017-2018. Stajan will be done 2018-2019. I don't think we're in a crunch where we got to start moving where we need to move salary caps just to get some young players under.
True.
You know, I would be shocked if we lost Goudreau and or Monahan because we couldn't afford them.
Oh, no. We have more than enough cap hit.
Exactly.
Where cap space that... You put it this way, if, say, Bennett was performing equally well and his contract was up at the same time, we'd be able to afford him as well. So, like, we could probably afford Hudler under that situation as well. So
I mean, you're right that we may not be positioned ideally the way we want to, but I don't think it's something we have to fix now. I don't think it's somewhere we need to make a trade to get under, you know, a certain salary cap, or we need to make a trade to get ourselves to a certain place. I think just looking at the salary cap and the way our contracts are organized, we could let these organically just sort themselves out.
It's just one of those things that, like, if a deal comes up, like, say you're getting offered a couple of prospects and a pick for one of your guys, that you would take it at the trade deadline, but it's November. I think you would be more apt to see that actually being accepted this year versus other years.
Yeah, no, that's all. And you're right. And, you know, we won't keep saying it, but yes, if a good trade comes along, you take it. Obviously, that's what a GM's job is. But without looking at just a good trade falling into your lap and what you're actively out there moving or trying to move, to me, I wouldn't be too worried about trying to actively move a piece of our salary just to get it off the books.
The only thing I would actively be looking to trade is one defenseman, just because the Flames have eight of them.
Yeah, but I don't think that's a salary reason, as you pointed out. I think you move them because you have a wealth and you can get some good back. You're not moving them out because I need to get rid of $2 million so I can sign somebody next year. That's a different reason you're moving them.
True. And that's more, we have eight defensemen, we only need six, and because we do have young players like Nakladl, my mistake, and Kulak and Watherspoon that could fill the seventh role easily, so.
And we'll talk about some of those trades and what some of the rumors we've been hearing. But to me, you know, when we're looking at this team in year three of a rebuild, not looking forward to a trade deadline or anything like that, to me, we're exactly where we want to be, both roster-wise. And you know what? Yeah, we're struggling. But we don't need to be a Stanley Cup team this year. It'd be nice after last year, but we don't need a Stanley Cup playoff appearance to be successful this year.
Well, like, if you look at organizationally, the Flames, in the last, say, 12 months, their biggest need in terms of the rebuild was acquiring young defensemen. And we got Dougie Hamilton. And yes, he struggled, but it's early.
But so is everybody, to be fair.
Yeah, well, like, even if you look at around the league, when Ryan Suter went to Minnesota, he initially was absolutely terrible. And like, for the first 10 games, he was terrible to the point where Wild fans were, oh, well, we just wasted X number of millions of dollars and we're screwed. And it was against us that he actually had his first good game as a Wild, because I remember it distinctively, because, great, you couldn't have waited one more game, but, you know, and it took him 10 games. Well, Hamilton, he's actually, the game against the Islanders, I thought was his best game as a Flame, and he's starting to turn the corner. So, you just have to be patient. Like, if he's struggling in January, February, that's a different conversation.
Or if he was the only guy struggling, we'd be having a different conversation,
yeah,
too. But to be fair, yes, he's struggling, but so is Wideman, so is Gio, so is England, so is Russell. Everyone's struggling on the blue line. Everyone's struggling up front, too.
Yeah. The only guy who's not is Gaudreau, and that's because it's Gaudreau.
So I think that he's been unfairly singled out as struggling. He's not the only one. If he was the only one, yeah, maybe we have a different conversation, but everyone's struggling.
Yeah, the whole team's bad, so, you know, it is what it is. But in addition to Hamilton, they also got Rasmus Anderson and Oliver Shillington, which that also helps with the defensive prospects. Now, I think that in terms of what the Flames need is some right wingers, and that's about it. So,
and we have a couple years where we can build those up too.
Yeah. So, but like, as you were saying, like, in terms of the third year of a rebuild, like, we have, you know, we have Monahan, we have Bennett, we have Jankowski, we have Granlund, Juris, Arnold, you know, wings, we got Poirier, Klimchuk, Hunter Smith, Austin Carroll, like a whole bunch of different guys, Agostino. Then defense, we've got Shillington, Morrison, Anderson, if you want to extend it, Brody and Hamilton. In the net, we've got Gillies, McDonald, Schneider, and Ordeo. So, like, it's not like we've just got Gaudreau and Monahan and that's it. So for being in the third year of a rebuild, we're perfectly fine. It's just...
Yeah, yes, it's disappointing based on what we saw last year from the Calgary Flames, but I think to me it's par for the course. I mean, we expected the Flames to be picking top three in the draft last year. So I think...
Yeah, like we were expect... Like, I remember this time last year that I was wanting the Flames to draft Oliver Shillington in the top five. And, you know, yes, we ended up getting him a 60th, but...
Well, we thought we might even be in the McDavid sweepstakes.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that's... At the time, that was the top five, was McDavid, Eichel, Hanifin, Shillington, and the other defenseman... I can't remember, but it doesn't matter.
So I think the fact that we're on a 2-7 record, yeah, it's disappointing. As a Flames fan, I'm disappointed. I want to see the team doing well. But the way I look at it is, you know what? We're exactly where we need to be.
Yeah, and if you look at it just from a strict asset perspective, yes, the Flames have a whole bunch of good young guys. But with having all these veterans as well, we can trade them.
Well, that's what I was saying earlier. And we have enough pieces to keep and enough pieces that we can...
Yeah.
We can either keep if we want to, or we can move to get another piece if we need to.
Well, like, if you look at last year, like, we got a second and a third for Glencross, a second for Berchi. So, if the same thing persists this season, then, you know, you've got Jones. You've got Hudler, who you'll get easily a first plus-plus. You know, you got Russell, you got Wideman, like, there's a whole bunch. Like, you could end up getting, like, five top 90 picks.
And it gives the GM a lot of options because of that.
Yes, and, like, you could see the same thing where the Flames go out and make the Dougie Hamilton trade again, but for another top young guy that somebody can't fit in their contract structure. Like, there's lots of different ways of going about it. It's just trying to figure out which avenue to go down.
Well, talking about trades, let's talk about two of the biggest trade rumors that we've heard come out over the past week. The first one, I think, is ludicrous myself. I'm not sure who put it out there, but apparently during the offseason, Tampa Bay was shopping Steven Stamkos, And it was reported that the Flames talked to the Lightning about Steven Stamkos, and now this rumor's taken off. I know people that are very casual Flames fans have been asking me about it. To me, in order to bring Steven Stamkos to Calgary in, again, year three of a rebuild, the return is too high to me. If I send like Bennett and probably Monahan and something else, we're done. We can't get rid of our young assets, even for Stamkos. Stamkos aside as a player, yes, we'd want to see him here. Would you want to see us give up what it would take to bring him in?
Well, let's just say that it was Bennett, Hudler, a first, plus, say, a Shillington. Just for sake
sure.
of argument.
Sounds like a reasonable package.
I wouldn't do that. I like Stamkos. I think he's a very good offensive player. But, like, especially if the Flames continue to struggle, I would just rather acquire draft picks and hope that, like, say, like, if the Flames are picking in the top five this year, you know, say the whole season sucks, well, you might get a guy that's comparable to a Monahan or something in the top five. I wouldn't bother at that rate signing Stamkos to like what will be a $10 million per year contract. It just in terms of both the acquisition cost and what it would cost to keep him, you're better off just saying thanks but no thanks and using the other assets to, you know, say like trading Hudler at the deadline and figuring something out some other way than that. Calgary just doesn't have the amount of high-end assets where they can shed two of them or more.
Well, we have the high-end assets, but we can't afford to give them up. If we were in a position where we were built for a Stanley Cup run, we had, you know, almost like we've seen with Chicago, where they put all their salary together, they have very little room, and they have to make the Stanley Cup that year and run all the way, or they're going to have to disassemble that team. Maybe you'd bring Stamkos in. Maybe you'd say, you know what, we're struggling. We have to do something. This makes sense. But for a team that's in the middle of a rebuild where we'd give up three or four of our top pieces, to me, it'd be a non-starter right there. As soon as you talk about shipping Bennett and, say, Monahan out in the same deal, I can't think of an asset that would make that worthwhile.
No. Like, even a prime Sidney Crosby, that would be tough.
Yeah, and then throw a first and, say, Shillington, as you mentioned. Again, I can't think of any package in the league based on where we are now. Yes, it'd be nice to have Steven Stamkos here. Yes, he'd be a great Flame. I'm not denying any of these things. But
no.
Based on where we are in our cycle, I cannot think of a package where getting rid of four of our top assets would make sense.
I know. No, that's, yeah. As much as one would like to see Stamkos in a Flames jersey, unless he signs here on July 1st, then no.
But even then, as you said, even if he were to sign here, we'd have to move a lot of guys to be able to afford him. And I don't know we could afford that either. I mean, it would be easier to stomach bringing him in as a UFA because we're not giving up assets, but we're going to have to then make some very interesting moves in order to be able to... I mean, right now we have 7 million cap space left, so... You know,
and it would be welcome to your buyout, England, Raymond, and Smead.
Well, but even buyouts we couldn't do because that would count against the cap for double the time. So
yeah, no.
You'd have to trade those assets. You couldn't buy them out.
Well, you could. It would free up $6 million. It would just cost you three the next season as well. Not ideal, but, you know, that's the only way that you know, in order to clear a Stamkos size but room in your budget, that's pretty much the only way you could do it.
The other trade rumor that we've heard this week, coming from a lot of sources, including some of the guys at TSN, is that the Flames have been shopping actively a defenseman, and that both Wideman and Russell have received calls from around the league from other teams, that the Flames have been fielding offers from both. The thing to remember about Wideman is that he does have a modified no-trade clause in his contract. So we don't know who's on the list of where he can go or who's not. But Matt, looking at those two guys, let's do them one at a time. Is there one that you'd rather see move? The Flames were going to move one of them, and you had, let's say, an equal offer. Because as you pointed out tonight, yes, we get a good deal, we'd take it. But if, say, we had a relatively equal offer, is there one guy you'd rather see traded?
Yeah, for me, Kris Russel. I like that he blocks shots, this, that, the next thing. It's just having a guy that's 5'10", 5'11", as a defenseman, unless the guy is Torrey Krug or some other equivalent guy, it's really tough. And he gets out-muscled, and that's why he's put into the situation where he needs to block all these shots. I like him. I wouldn't want to see him get traded, but if somebody has to go and you get a good offer, you know, sorry, but that's who I would go with.
See, to me, I'm the other way. And, you know, I know Wideman has got a lot of criticism as a Flame. I think that he's been unfairly criticized a lot of years as a Flame, but he's the older guy. He has shown, I think, less as a Flame overall than Russell has. He's also got a bigger contract. We've got about $11 million tied up with Wideman this year and next year. And I think that moving Wideman out might give a little bit more room for maybe a guy like Russell or someone else to step in and play a top four role and see what we've got there, especially if we're going to be out of the playoffs. Maybe not Russell, maybe Smead, maybe Nakladal, maybe, you know, somebody else who could step in and show us. Because when we got Russell, we didn't think there was anything special either, and he's really shown us he has something. So, I don't know, to me it would make more sense to move the older guy, which is Dennis Wideman.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I just, unfortunately with Russell, I think he might be the most overrated player on the Flames, in the Flames organization, just because of, he blocked an NHL record amount of shots, and I'm not one to subscribe to Corsi and all that too often, but his numbers in that metric is terrible. He's the league worst in the plus minus thus far this season, and you know he's just not been very good defensively whatsoever.
But nobody has.
True, but he more so than anybody, in my opinion, has been the worst player for the Flames. So that's part of the reason why I would deal him.
I can see, realistically, as much as I can't see Stamkos coming, I can realistically see Wideman or Russell being moved within the next month.
I could honestly see both if the right deal comes up, but
I just can't see getting a deal to move both of them out of here.
It wouldn't be one trade, it would be two, and likely in one of those trades you'd get somebody back that you could put on, you know, like a young defenseman that you could stick in.
See, but as you've already mentioned, we need wingers right now, so I don't even think I'd trade for a defenseman. I think if we're going to trade one of those guys, we have to bring back a top six, top nine forward.
True, but if you're trading both, you could get, like, the winger guy in one trade and the defenseman guy in the other.
But you've also said you want them to acquire draft picks. Would you want to bring in another defenseman, or would you want them to use that to restock the draft cupboard? I mean, one's not right or wrong, but, you know, if we're talking about a rebuild...
it's one of those things that, like, a likely trade with either of those players, you're likely going to get one prospect and one draft pick minimum. You might even have to take on a contract as well.
For Wideman, you might. For a $2.6 million Kris Russel on a 1 year, I don't think you'd have to take anything back.
No, you're correct on that regard.
Dennis Wideman's 5.2 for 2 years. That's where you might have to take on a bad contract.
Yeah. Even if it's just for, like, the 1 year.
Yeah.
You know, Or, like, if you, say, traded Wideman to, say, Chicago, you might have to take Bickle back, but who cares at that rate? If you're getting the adequate prospects back, who cares? But it's just one of those things that it would really depend on what the trade was and who you're trading with. If you're going to get a really dynamite prospect, then you get the dynamite prospect.
Well, of course. And
it's just
and
a so-so prospect, then you lean more to getting a good draft pick. So
if you were out there shopping, though, if you were the GM and you were putting these guys out there and putting a price on them, what would that price be?
I would defer more to the draft pick, just because I believe that, like, defensively, Kulak and Morrison are close. But okay. Then again, it, you know, you don't know what's on the market. So yeah. If you got a really dynamite defensive prospect included in one of those trades, you're like, okay, thank you, see you.
Yeah, I think it's too early in the year to see dynamite prospects moved yet, though.
Oh, no, and I agree with you there. It's one of those things that if you get the dynamite prospect, you go that route. If not, then you go the draft pick route. And that would really just depend on what the market is.
To me, I think if I'm moving Russell, and I'm, of course, you know, we can debate of what might be out there, all that sort of thing, but if I'm putting an asking price on him, if teams are phoning me saying, what's the cost for Russell? I'd be telling teams, not taking back anything bad, any bad contracts. I'm looking for a top six, maybe top nine forward, a winger.
Okay, here's a trade offer for you. Kris Russel for David Perron.
Yeah, I'd do that. Would you?
Yes, probably. Just, it'd be tough, but yeah, I'd probably go that route just because Perron might help the Flames better.
I think Perron's a guy who could maybe use a change of scenery.
Yeah.
I also think Perron might play well with Michael Frolik.
That would be one of those situations that Perron might only be here for a little while. You know what I mean? Like, you might, because he's a free agent at the end of the year as well, so...
But if you're trading, if you're trading a rental for a rental, it doesn't really matter.
You might just hold on to him for a few months, and if he doesn't click, then you just trade him at the deadline.
Yep. But I think if I'm trading Wideman, I don't think you're going to get the same type of player back because you're doing a team a big favor of taking back a bad contract. I think if I'm out there shopping Wideman, I'd definitely be looking for a couple draft picks, and then that one piece that I need to take back, like you said, maybe a Bickle or something like that, in order to move, because not a lot of teams have $5.25 million right now to play with. So I think if I'm trading Wideman, it's more of a long-term investment.
Yeah, like say like you were to trade him to Chicago for Bickle, Dano in a second, well then yeah, of course you do that trade. It's just, are you gonna get that offer of a couple of good prospects to go along with eating Bickle's contract? So we'll see.
I also think that because Russell is a UFA at the end of the year, you have to be careful trying to trade him now. I mean, Wideman, it doesn't really matter, but I think Russell, you really have to ask yourself, could I get a better deal for him if I wait till the deadline? To me, there's no reason he needs to be moved. He's not a cancer in the dressing room. He's not screwing up. Could I get a better deal if I hang on to him until the trade deadline?
True. And for that reason, I would expect, like, if one of them's traded, it would be Wideman first.
That's part of the reason I think Wideman will go first as well, because even at the deadline, moving a guy with another year on his contract doesn't generally net you a lot.
Yeah. And, like, one of the things that I'm leery about, like, they were talking on the Calgary Puck about... some rumors about what Russell's ask is, and it's close to like Chris Tanev's money for Vancouver, which is 4.55 per season, which is basically TJ Brody money. And like, that's another reason why.
And I mean, if we look at the defensemen after this year, we've got Hamilton is going to be making 5.7. Wideman is going to be making 5.2. Brody will be making 4.6. And Gio will be making 6.7. So you definitely are going to need one or two lower priced defensemen in there. And I could see re-signing Russell for 2.9, 3.2, somewhere in there. But I don't think he's worth anywhere near what Brody's making.
Yeah. Like, that's another reason why I'm a little leery with him. Yeah. So,
but no, if the Flames feel they need to move one of the two, to me, if I was the GM, without knowing the deals that he's actually had on the table, I'd be actively shopping Wideman now. And I'd probably, unless a fantastic deal comes my way, I think I'd probably wait till the deadline and see what I can get for Russell.
Yeah, I could see that.
But I think especially the deadline, if you were to put together something like Russell and Hudler going to one team together, you might be able to get a lot back for that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, the Flames could be your one-stop shop. You got your David Jones, your Hudler, and your Russell. You know, You need a goalie. We got two.
Yeah, I don't know that any one team could absorb that much salary.
No,
but you're right. I mean, we could have a lot of pieces in the works, but I just think that Russell could be thrown in with some later, be it David Jones, Jari Hudler, a goalie, something, and we might be able to get a lot more back at the deadline.
Oh, for sure. And either way, you know, like, that's why, like, people being, like, all frustrated with how the season is going, there's always positives. And the positives in this case are that the Flames have a bunch of players that are on expiring contracts that they can use in trade. Now, ideally, that, you know, you wouldn't want that to be the situation.
Well, I think realistically, though, we know some of these guys are moving either way.
Yeah, like the odds of David Jones being a Flame after the deadline, even if the Flames were in the playoff hunt, was small anyway.
Apparently, Jari Hudler is asking for more than we're willing to pay him. It's from everything I've heard, it's pretty sure that he's not coming back. Russell at $4 million is not coming back. So yeah, you're right. I mean, if we're not in the playoffs, at least we have assets that we can say, okay, we didn't make the playoffs, but let's spin these assets into something good. It's not like we're sitting at the bottom of the league going, crap, we have nothing to show from this year.
Yeah, exactly. Like, oh, we're only going to get the one pick and that's it. At least the Flames have the opportunity to get better moving forward, even if this year might not be so good.
Yeah. So, and that, again, that's to me part of a rebuild is having the assets you need in order to get what you need out of it. You know, I mean, this year we needed a defenseman and we traded assets because we had them in a couple first round picks to get the asset we needed in Dougie Hamilton. So if we can parlay those assets into something, I think that also goes to speaking to success on the season.
Oh yeah. And like, how would you say, like, say Dougie Hamilton is only basically a faster Dennis Wideman moving forward. Well, you still need that. So,
and at about $500,000 a year more, yeah, sure. I mean, he's going to be making 5.75, and Weidman's making 5.25, so even if he's slightly better than Wideman, it makes sense. That's how he's being paid.
Yeah, and we'll see. He has the potential to, like, if he rounds out his defensive game, to be a lot better than Wideman. If he's only just a slightly better version of him, well, that's useful too. So, we'll see.
So, Matt, you wanted to chat a little bit about John Gillies and the start that he and the Adirondack, or the Stockton Heat, have had to the season.
Yeah, his season's been rather bizarre. In the first game, he had a shutout, and he wasn't really tested that much. Then the next game, he was tested a few times, and he pretty much let in every single scoring chance and surrendered 4 goals. Then the next game, the Stockton Heat were, it was pretty much a turkey shoot. It was the Heat were getting outplayed significantly. I think the shots were something like 37-17 in that game. And yet Gillies stood on his head and got the shutout. Then the next game on Saturday, this past Saturday, he surrendered 5 goals on 25 shots. It's like, you know, he's either extremely good to the point where he gets a shutout, or, you know, he's like any other Flames goalie this season.
Yeah, but, you know, and I don't know how the teams looked in front of him, but he's also a young goalie. He's in his first year of professional hockey. So I was expecting there to be a little bit of a learning curve, a little bit of an adjustment period as he jumps into the pro game.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It's just odd to see shutout 4 goals against, shutout 5 goals against. Like, not, it, you know, it's just weird to see that kind of inconsistency. The Heat, you know, the first game they were really good. They won 7-0. The second game, even though they lost 4-1, they were the better team in that game. But the last two, boy, have they been terrible. Like, really, like, they, worse than how they played against the Islanders, bad.
Wow.
In each of those games. So, we'll see.
The interesting thing, if we look at the Heat's schedule, is they play pretty much a lot of weekend hockey in the AHL, for those that don't know. And if we look at their upcoming schedule, they have back-to-backs against San Diego on the 30th and 31st. Then they don't play again until November 6th and 7th. Then they don't play again until November 13th, 14th. So really, in the next three series, if you will, over the next 3 weeks, they play three back-to-back series. So I think you might also see Gillies start to feel a bit of a challenge there, because I imagine Ramo and him are going to swap those series back and forth. So you might see Gillies, maybe he needs to sit and watch and learn from Ramo a bit, and that might be a good thing he's down there. Or maybe it makes Gillies, you know, look better, because now he's got somebody to compete with.
Yeah, and at least having Ramo down there, it helps to have a veteran NHL goaltender to work with Gillies as well, instead of him just trying to figure it all out on his own.
I feel bad for Simpson, the goalie they signed down there, because he just got signed to a new organization. He's looking to play in the AHL, and all of a sudden it's like, what? I'm on my way to the ECHL? Oh, man.
Yeah. Now I gotta go to Adirondack.
For no fault of his own, either.
No. I know. Well, it is what it is. I'm hoping that Simpson has a good streak in Adirondack, so he proves that he has worth moving forward. Maybe he gets a later season recall.
To the Flames?
To the Heat.
Oh, yeah, I was going to say, the Flames, there's a lot of goalies who'd be above
him.
Yeah,
no, that would be like a 99-2000 Flames situation. I was going to say, where
if we're at the point where we're recalling Simpson, this season is off the rails.
Oh, yeah. You've got like eight injuries to your goaltenders.
We'll end up finding Tyler Moss again and Brathwaite and telling them to put the pads on as well.
Yeah. Kelly Rudy, you're in.
That's right. You can call the game from the net.
Yeah. Helmet cam.
Yeah, well, I don't know if you need the camera necessarily, but he can do the team's at the other side of the ice, he can do his color commentary.
Yeah, it's sort of like the All-Star game.
Well, Matt, I think that's probably the majority of the issues for this week, unless there's anything else you think we need to address?
Not really. That's not a huge amount to talk about with how the Flames have played lately.
It's disappointing, but to me, it's par for the course.
Yeah, it's one of those things that you would always want your team, regardless of what situation they're in, to be the best team in the league and win the Stanley Cup. But realistically, this team struggling isn't the end of the world, and there will still be positives even if things don't work right now. Like, the team will be fine next year and moving forward. It's just, it is what it is. It happens.
Yeah, and I think too, you know, remember, as we said, that we're in this position this time last year. We were talking about the Flames being at the rock bottom, and they surprised us. So we may not get a second-round playoff appearance. We may not get a Stanley Cup Finals appearance. But hopefully this team will find a way to surprise us again.
Yeah, and realistically, as long as all the players, the young guys, continue to have forward progress and not completely flame out, that's the important thing, even if the team itself struggles.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, with even teams like Anaheim looking terrible as well, I'm not saying we'll make it to the playoffs, but you might see the Flames surprise us in how far we get in the Pacific Division. I think that our division, which once looked like the hardest division in the league, isn't looking as tough anymore, and we might be surprised by what we can accomplish.
Oh, for sure. The only teams that are looking good thus far is Los Angeles and San Jose. So, you know, and Anaheim, they're losing again. So it's way too early. So,
well, Matt, let's get out of here. But before we do, we always have to make our weekly predictions. For the rest of the week, we have three games. The end of our week of 5 games, 7 days. I have no idea how the Flames ended up with 5 games and 7 days in the schedule. That seems silly to me, but it happened, so we got to play our way through this. Wednesday night, the Flames travel to our nation's capital. They play the Senators in Ottawa. Then they'll be coming back here on Friday to play against the Montreal Canadiens and Carey Price. And Saturday night, we have the Oilers. Last week, neither of us did very well. We had 8 points on the table. I thought that we'd beat the Wings, and I thought that we might get a point against the Islanders, I believe, and you thought we'd get 4 points with a Wings-Islanders win. So
nobody in Flames land is doing very good.
We got 2 points on the week, which means you're still up with 1 week that you won, which is the first week, and I have none.
Yeah.
What does Aaron Ward think about the team this year? Do we know?
Nobody knows.
We got to ask Aaron Ward. He obviously knows how the Flames do.
Yeah. For this week, I'm going to go with 2 points. I think they'll beat Ottawa, and then I think they'll drop the next two.
Yeah? You think we'll drop our second Edmonton game in a row?
Yeah.
It's going to sting.
Oh, yeah.
That's going to sting. I've been predicting a lot of weird numbers so far. I've been, I think, more optimistic than I should be. After the Islanders game, I don't have as much faith in us beating Ottawa. I'm going to go for 2 points as well, but I think we're going to get the 2 points against Montreal.
Okay.
I don't know. I think Montreal, they have a tendency sometimes to overestimate teams or underestimate teams, I should say, and come in and sort of play cocky.
Yeah.
And I think that the Flames might be able to take advantage of that. I also don't know if Montreal is going to play Carey Price. I think you might see him sit that one out. And if he does, I don't even know who the backup is in Montreal, but we've got a shot against them.
Yeah.
Do you know who their backup is?
Couldn't tell you.
I'll look it up. It's like when you used to see these goalies, these dynasty goalies like Cujo and Brodeur, and nobody ever knew who backed them up.
Yeah, like a Brodeur, and you had like Scott Clemenson.
Exactly.
And,
the backup in Montreal is Mike Condon, a 25-year-old goalie. I've never even heard of the guy.
No.
Apparently he's played 2 NHL games in his career. He played ECHL and AHL. He split some time there, so he sounds like a guy we could put some pucks by.
Yeah.
But yeah, unfortunately, I agree with you that I think we're going to drop our second game to Edmonton.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those things that the Flames, with how poorly their defense has been, I don't see them being able to contain a guy like McDavid. And, like, you need your guys to be on the top of their game, and the Flames are far from that at the moment, so.
You know, with the amount of talk I've heard about McDavid since the season started, they might as well just rename the NHL to the MHL, the McDavid Hockey League. It seems like he's the only player in the entire league that matters.
Pretty much. Well, it was the same nauseating experience when Crosby was first in the league, so.
Like, yes, he's a good player, but there's more interesting storylines out there to be covered. When Edmonton's pushing for a playoff spot, sure, I'll listen to McDavid news. But until then, there's other stuff going on that's more interesting.
Oh, I know. And, like, they lost again tonight, and I think they're 3-5 or 3-6 right now.
So they're not doing much better than us.
No. So, like, for how much the Flames have struggled, if they win, say that Winnipeg game, say they won that one, well, we would be tied with Edmonton right now.
Well, let's say we come out and we win the next two.
Exactly. Like, you know, it's one of those things that, yeah, he's good, but Gaudreau, I think, has the same or more points than him right now. So, okay, yeah, you've got a good player, but the rest of your team's not very good, so.
Yeah, no, it's just,
so what?
there's to me, there's more interesting storylines going on around the league. And all we hear is McDavid this, McDavid that. It's like, you know what? Show us that Edmonton deserves some press, because over the past couple years they haven't. They didn't win the draft lottery. They've been terrible for years. So, you know, show us you deserve some press before we give you press.
Exactly. Like, talk about how the Anaheim Ducks are as bad as they are.
Exactly.
You know, like, that's the biggest story in my mind.
But the only stories I seem to be seeing is that Tortorella's got work again, and then McDavid.
Yeah. And which I'm glad that Tortorella, he's a good coach in the right situation where your team needs someone to yell at you. That's the good fit for Tortorella. And the Jackets, with how they've started, they need somebody to come in and just yell at them.
I said it last year, and I still believe it. I think that before we see Edmonton win a Stanley Cup, I would not be surprised if Tortorella ends up there. I think at some point you need a guy like him to whip that team into shape.
Yeah, I agree. I actually thought that that's who they should have went with this offseason instead of McClellan. But
yeah, but I don't think that he's necessarily a... I don't think he's the kind of guy that their new GM wants to bring in as sort of the new generation. But I think I wouldn't be surprised if you see him in the next 6 years.
Neither would I. The Oilers need somebody to whip them into shape. Whether it's Tortorella or a Tortorella-type guy,
where's
they
Keenan?
Need somebody. He's getting Russian citizenship.
Is he hiding from somebody?
No, he's coaching over there. I think they want him to coach their national team in the next Olympics.
Oh, wow.
So he's getting his Russian citizenship because that's part of the caveat that you have to be a citizen in order to coach the team.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So Iron Mike is behind the iron wall.
That's a good way to look at it. Maybe they should put him behind a wall on the bench. Well, Matt, let's hope for some better results. Let's hope that of the next 6 points, we can walk away with, let's say, at least three of them. See if we can go 500 on the rest of the week.
Yeah. Well, I'm just hoping for a victory at some point.
A victory would be nice.
Yeah.
Instead of there.
What happened in the weekend. So we'll see. We'll have lots to chat about next week anyway.
I hope
either
so.
Way.
You have a good week, and we'll talk to you next week.
Yeah, thanks for listening, everybody.
This show is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license information, visit firesidechat.ca.